It's the appointed time for the meeting, and we have a quorum. Let me call to order the special meeting of the panel on welfare services. We have a public hearing on the analysis of poverty situation of Hong Kong and also the setting of a target for poverty elimination. I can see deputations having come in, and on the other side, we should have the administration. Can we invite them to come in now? This may be the longest marathon public hearing in this session. We have received 105 applications. Like, first of all, to thank you all, because we'd like to speak on this issue from different aspects so that bit by bit we can push for the implementation of policies. There are four sessions of the public hearing today, two in the morning, two in the afternoon, and we should make the best use of our time. I'd like to remind deputations that you have a microphone, you have an earpiece, and you can tune into the different languages if you so desire. I'd like to remind you that your oral remarks are not protected or covered by the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance, Cap 382. Secretary, at the start of the meeting, can you walk us through your paper? 5 minutes. Thank you. We have submitted a paper to introduce to members the analysis of the poverty situation in Hong Kong in 2017. In brief, compared to 2016, including the recurrent cash intervention policy, the poverty rate stands at 14.7%. If we include non-cash recurrent policy, the poverty rate would lower to 10.5%. I won't go into the details in the paper because I believe members would like to listen more to deputations. Thank you. Thank you very much, Secretary. We will now start the public hearing. Everyone will have 3 minutes. First of all, Ms. Cheng Chi Wai. Chairman, our coffers are flooding with money and the reserves stand at over $1,000 billion. But now there are over 1 million Hong Kong people living under the poverty line. We have almost the highest poverty rate in the world. We are an affluent society, but we have a bigger and bigger poor population. The situation is worsening for the elderly in particular. The secretaries are earning $10,000 every day. You hardly know the dire strait of the public. Of course, you have to cut your clothes according to the cloth, but then you have so much cloth, and yet you don't do anything for housing, elderly services and other welfare services. You are so stingy with these provisions. We do not have a sound retirement protection scheme. And yet, this year, you are heightening the threshold for elderly CSSA to 65 years. You are not respecting our elderly. You have the money, but you refuse to spend for the welfare of the elderly. And if you have bread, why would you want to give it up? You say CSSA is a safety net, but elderly people who rely on CSSA just cannot afford the self-support medicine in the formulary. If they spend money on medication, they have no money for food. If they contract cancer and they have to use target medication, they can just wait for the death. I am in the catering sector. I am delivering meals to elderly people who can hardly survive on the meager help from the administration. But the owners of properties always give me trouble. I don't know for how long I can sustain my efforts. I can tell you that even middle-class elderly people are getting poorer and poorer. The property manager of my shop told me that some anonymous elderly people are telling him that actually there should not be the charge of tea fees and also 10% service charge because they have no money. If you do not face up to this poverty situation, the situation will become even worse. Thank you. I hope you will continue with your efforts in distributing meals to the elderly. Ms. Wong Soon from Civic Party. I am Wong Man Hoon, Chairman. I am the Development Officer for Hong Kong East. I remember there is this line in a film, and I always remember it. It says, there is only one sickness in the world, and it is called poverty. People are living in despair. In 2018, the COP report said that there were 590,000 households which are poor in 2016, meaning one in five. And the Gini coefficient registered 0.539 in 2016, ranking top in the whole wide world. It is said that there is a slight increase of the poverty population in 2017, and you say it doesn't mean that you have done less for the poor. However, the CP is of the view that even if you include cash policy, and also if there is an increase of 21.3% of welfare spending in 2018 to 19, there is no improvement in the Gini coefficient. So your work is not effective. We believe you have to provide basic needs for the grassroots and also poor people. You need to take different measures. You have to lower rent expenditure. It is shown that in 2016, people are paying 30% to rent housing.
Okay, would they be able to make any savings? For the medium long term, I think the government should provide rental subsidies and allowance for children, increase cash subsidy for low-income families. In the long run, I think we should, the government should build more public housing to satisfy the needs of the grassroots. And also, we should help children so that, so therefore we propose that we should, you know, provide more, you know, childcare services, and also we should provide subsidies for the tenants, and we should improve the CSSA system. The CSSA system has not been able to catch up with the rate of inflation. We should review the level of CSSA payment, and we should also provide renovation, removal, relocation allowance, allowance for spectacles and so on. And fourthly, we should review the retirement protection and elderly CSSA payment. I think the government should, you know, suspend the amendment of the age entitlement for elderly CSSA payments. In the long term, we should review the CSSA system and the eligibility to find out whether we can really help alleviate poverty of the elderly. I think using the poverty line to measure the size of the poor population does not reflect the commitment of the government to eliminate poverty. The government should make reference of overseas experience and setting target for the next 5 to 10 years to come up with poverty alleviation policies to improve the standard of living for the people of Hong Kong. Next, Mr. Kok Wai Shing. Thank you. Good morning, my name is Kok Wai Shing. The topic today is the analysis of the poverty situation in Hong Kong, and I would like to first of all quote some simple statistics. In 2019, the poverty population is 1.35 million. In 2017, the poverty population is now 1.377 million. The waiting time for public housing is 5.5 years. So that's the poverty situation. Let's talk about the rich. In 2008, we have 26 multi-billionaires, and in 2018, the number has gone up to 67. Indeed, for the super rich, this is really, a very, satisfactory number. The most affluent households own more than 50% of the wealth of Hong Kong. The Gini ratio is 0.539, a record high in the last four odd decades. All these apparently, cold numbers or figures actually reflect the pathetic story of Hong Kong. These figures are so ironic due to the inequitable allocation of resources. And because of that, the poverty gap is becoming more and more serious. The affluent is becoming richer and richer. As I said, you have 67 multi-billionaires, and the number is will probably go up further. As for the poor, they are becoming even poorer. It's now 2.3 something million, and Mr. Law, I think you can project that in 10 years from now, how large will be the population of the poor households? If the government doesn't do anything, that number will only continue to go up. Talking about the unequal distribution of wealth in Hong Kong, I think we look at our tax system. The profit tax is very low. The highest is 66.5%. The rich people make so much, and yet you're charging them such little tax. And this is entirely, not compatible with the principle that the rich should pay more. I suggest that for the really rich people, we should charge them an affluence tax. If the money made by these rich people, if they could be more equitably distributed to the rank and file population, I think this is what the government should do. If we use such tax proceeds to help the poor and spend more on public welfare, it will not benefit 1% of the rich, but 99% of the grassroots population. Thank you very much. Next, Mr. Koi Kin from the Labour Party. Thank you. The three earlier speakers have already commented on the poverty situation in Hong Kong. The Secretary, Mr. Law, is very busy, posting articles on his website. On the 2nd of October last year, he actually wrote an article about the poverty numbers in Hong Kong. It more or less reflects Mr. Law's attitude on the question of poverty. Indeed, we have 1 million poor people. It's 1.37 million, but in his blog, the Secretary said that we should look at the number, which is $1.01 million. The $1.38 million is before policy intervention. Then that doesn't seem to be very important. But for the government's poverty alleviation policy, are we talking about primary distribution or secondary allocation? Is it that you have failed in your first primary allocation policy, and that's why you're saying that the 1.3 million is not very important? The government actually has a role in terms of the primary allocation. Why can't the government lower the number in the pre policy intervention number? And we're also talking about we also like to ask for example when we're going to have collective bargaining. Secondly, the Secretary said in his blog that you have, when talk about the poverty line, that somebody said that the government spent 20.9 billion, we can totally eliminate poverty, and the Secretary disagrees. He said that if nobody can receive the medium household income without having to work, there won't be any incentive for people to take up employment, and the government will need to pay out more. Logically, that may be right, but I think if we play with words like that, then I think instead the government should really, you may not have to spend 20.9 million, we could be talking about $30 or $40 billion. But at the policy level, we're not asking you to simply spend $2 billion to plug the gap, but rather we're talking about your present and future policies, which can step up your effort to alleviate poverty. You're saying that they're saying that those who work harder will earn more. But given the stringent eligibility criteria and the vetting criteria and the welfare measures are so mean, how can you help those working poor? Thirdly, you say that you put it, the question is why can't you do two things together. Is it that you are now providing very good service? If you say that you're going to substantially increase the provision of service and the cash, you know, measures may not have to, cannot, may not have to go up that by so much. We understand, but you're not providing very good service and you're only providing limited cash subsidy. So how can we be convinced that you are determined to tackle poverty and the cash measures cannot catch up with inflation, and what you spend is less, is very small in percentage terms compared with the GDP. The full amount is only 1,000. Is it that there is objection? Thank you. I think we should really look into the pre-policy intervention and after policy intervention numbers. Yes, I am a church missionary myself, and our church, I think we in the church, we would read the Bible every morning, and let's try to understand poverty from the religious perspective. The Bible says that if you have poor people in the city, if there are poor people, you can't be so cold-hearted and ignore them. The Bible says that you must lend a helping hand and to replenish or to make up for what he is lacking. And he said, so section 9 said that if you don't help these poor people, and these people have to pray to God for help, then you would have sinned. We know that the poverty population, we're told that 1 out of 5 people in Hong Kong is poor. Based on that phenomenon, apparently the situation in Hong Kong is not compatible with the principles, according to the Bible. That is, according to the Bible, there shouldn't be any poor people. So I think we need to set a poverty elimination target and conduct a review. Now, in the eyes of God, I think we should respect the elderly. When we help the people, now for the poor and the elderly who are poor, I think we should recognize their contribution. Last year, we asked whether or not we can respect the scavengers and consider the scavenging as a population. And I think we should also not smear the image of CSSA system. Our church has actually taken care of many of the homeless people, and many of them refused to actually apply for CSSA payment. So thanks to the government's, API, they always try to smear, the image of these CSSS payments. And thirdly, from the educational front, our poverty alleviation policy and our CSSS system, I think there should be compassion. We insist on objecting to, amending the CSSS system. I think we should have a reasonable safety net. We should review the whole CSSA system. Finally, our home for the elderly, for the homeless. The government policy is not really helping those in need. So I hope the members and the secretary will hear the voice of the elderly poor. Madam Lai Kam-man from the DAB. Thank you. I'm Lai Kam-man from the DAB. Today, I'd like to talk about the government adopting the poverty line as a tool to analyze the poverty situation. The COP in 2012 was regrouped, and every year it will set the poverty line and use that to update the poverty figures. There's a benefit in that, other than helping society to quantify the poverty situation, it can also help us carry out analysis and make comparison, and also by using such data, we can monitor the poverty situation. Since after the quantification, the DAP, regarding the government's current policy, including the non-recurring cash measures, we wonder whether or not it can really help alleviate poverty, we would need to make an analysis based on composite data in order that we can understand the effectiveness of the current measures and how we can improve. We hope that the COP will focus on the poor population and set a target for poverty elimination and come up with, you know, focused measures in order to reduce the number of poor people and to narrow the poverty gap. Also, given that the poverty line in Hong Kong is measured, it is based on income. The measure is based on income. Those people who don't have income or those who earn very meager income but still own substantial assets are still regarded as poor. Many people can feel that the quality of life has not been taken in consideration, and therefore the families would qualify as poor. Households which are classified as poor, for example, elderly who have substantial assets, households or families which are poor people who have to pay substantial percentage of the income to pay mortgages. Under the current definition, you're not able to reflect the true situation. The DAP hopes that the government will address this issue. We propose that outside of the poverty line, there should be objective life standard, you know, indicators so that we can really gauge the actual poverty situation. Next. Mr. Chiu Lok Fai, thank you. We are an action-oriented organization. We actually reach out to the Kai Fong to help them. Over the past 5 years, we've gone to different districts. We've become acquainted with many Kai Fongs, including scavengers and cleaning workers. Among the cleaning workers, I found that most of them are over 60, and they very often will take up two jobs. They will work a morning shift and an afternoon shift. Why is it that they have to work 18 hours a day? It's because they are paid a very meager hourly rate. In the last couple of months, we've helped many workers to apply for
Let us look at the situation of contract workers for the government. In 2017, it dropped to 3.1%, and I'm talking about the unemployment rate. However, this doesn't mean that grassroots wages have gone up. In fact, they have been suffering from lower and lower wages. They are the working poor. Their income is lower than half of the median household income. Without government intervention, if we only look at the distribution of income in society, there are 594,000 households, or 36.4% of them are poor working households. The government has contracted out work at the GPA, Housing Department, FEHD, and LCSD. Altogether, you are hiring 40,000 contract workers, and it is said that 60% of them earn not more than $36.50. You say it is for efficiency, but you are actually creating the working poor. If you look at your situation report in 2017, you again emphasize your cash intervention and non-cash intervention, and that the rate stands at 14.7% and then 10.5% respectively. You have been distributing cash subsidies like the OALA and also the working family subsidy. You want to make them out as very effective, and you are calculating this into household income for 2017. You have been using these vague figures in order to turn a blind eye to the poor state the poor people are in. You are just giving us cold and hard figures. I think you should set up living wages. Some NGOs have said that it should be between $50 to $55. The CE says that she is being empathetic and compassionate, in amending the Fugitive Offenders Ordinance. I'd like to ask her why she doesn't apply the same mentality to the 1.38 million poor people in Hong Kong. We invited LW Bureau staff and the CE to come to the front line, go to the districts and listen to them. And then you won't say people can work at 60 and that there will be a lot of choices still in the job market. That is very inhuman and callous. Thank you, Mr. Lai. Number 12, please give him the mic. Thank you. We are here to review Hong Kong's poverty situation and setting up a target for poverty elimination. I'd like to ask the Secretary a question. Please, Chairman, ask these two questions on my behalf later on. One, what do you mean by dignity? I don't think you have an answer because your officials at the National Anthem Bills Committee didn't know. I think you don't know either. And secondly, how much do you think a catty of cartons fetches in the market? And three, how much is a mega pounder in the market? I'd like to know whether you can answer those three questions. Coming to this public hearing, I really have to criticize the administration. You sit in an air-conditioned room. You are not going to be able to solve the poverty situation. You are bureaucratic. Your attitude can explain fully why you have rolled out cash subsidies and poverty alleviation policies. However, the poverty situation has remained. If you just look at the hard and cold figures, you are telling the public that the poverty situation has improved, we have full employment, and we have a smaller poverty population. Well, you are audacious enough to talk about that. But if you are in the community, if you look at the situation on the ground, I am sure you won't come to such a conclusion. I was talking about dignity. Some deputations mentioned rag pickers. I work in the districts in Chiang Kwan O, and I was asking rag pickers in the district whether they applied for CSSA, whether they have OALA. They said no, because they think that's kind of alms, and the OALA subjects them to a lot of vetting, and it doesn't give them dignity. We have an aging population. However, the administration is not doing anything to tackle the poor elderly problem. And we don't have a population policy either. Our population policy will steer the direction of a poverty policy. Yet we don't have one. We don't know how our population is going to develop. So you cannot roll out effective poverty alleviation policies. I'd like to ask you to do the following. You must be empathetic and treat people with dignity. Second, you must have a population policy. So we have an objective. And three, you must have the determination to tackle elderly poverty and also working poor problems so we can have harmonious development in society. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Tan Wing Him. Thank you, Chair. We are very concerned about the poverty situation of rag pickers. In March last year, we did a territorial survey. We surveyed 505, and many of them are up to the age of 69. In other words, most rag pickers are elderly people, and only 20% of them receive elderly CSSA. In the course of the interview, they said that they would choose work over welfare because there is this stigma for people receiving CSSA in society. In terms of work, 60% of them have less than $5,000 in income every month. They work in lowly menial jobs. That's true also for many grassroots elderly people. And we'd like to make the following proposals. One, you should provide a friendly environment for the elderly to work. What is your blueprint for the next 5-10 years? What are your objectives? Can elderly people who work tackle their poverty situation? Many of them work in labor-intensive work like cleaners, rag picking, washing dishes, and security guards. They don't have a lot of choice, and they are becoming weak and frail. So working is not an option for them. We do not have retirement protection schemes. Elderly people are working because they need to survive and support their families. If there is no proper planning, elderly working would mean they are the elderly poor. We hope departments can understand the situation of grassroots. I think 3 members participated in our rag picking experience. We invited the secretary, but he was too busy. But we'll continue to send you the invitation. And empathy should not be too distinguished. And no matter who you are working, you must be empathetic in helping those people through training, through experience. I hope departments can understand these people. The Environment Bureau chose to ignore the plight of rag pickers. There is no support for rag pickers, and you do not confirm their contribution to society. They have very low income, and no one recognizes their work. Last, you should consider universal retirement protection so they have some dignity in their sunset years. If you look at rag pickers, you will know how government is neglecting the poor in our society. In fact, they know very well how to keep and bring up a family. They have their own skills, but when they get old, they have little choice in getting a job. So you have to be human and empathetic in helping the elderly. Next, Ms. Chen Yiquan. Thank you. I'm from the field of educating young people about poverty. We have been collecting voices from secondary school students. In 2015, we got 5,000 such views, and 70% said that policies were ineffective in tackling poverty, especially structural poverty. And there is no planning for resources distribution, and nothing has happened in the last 10 years. We are baffled whether government has the determination to tackle poverty. It's not that you are unable, it's just that you are unwilling. Mr. Law, we are disappointed that you think poverty elimination is not possible. We know the poverty line is not perfect. It is just an excuse for not making policies for alleviating poverty. You should provide different kinds of assistance for people who are at different levels of the poverty ladder. We have reason to believe that unfair resource distribution and also social systems have something to do with a person who is poor. It is not just his own responsibility. And you are not filling the gaps in your policy. You do not tackle institutional policy, and we believe you have the responsibility to fairly distribute resources and also preserve systemic justice. What have you done about these in making policies? Why is it that civil servants have a raise of their salaries every year, but the statutory minimum wage is reviewed only every 2 years? And also, it is way below the standard of living. We think there should be an annual review of SMW, and there should be the setting of a living wage. And you are not rewarding those who work hard. Housing is a basic right, but it has become a commodity. I hope you won't use a free market as your front. You should do something with rent control. You should really tackle these unfair policies and set up mechanisms to assess the different impacts. Chairman, we are very concerned that as the administrator of policies, what is your view on poverty? You say we should be caring, but then CSSA is conditional, it is punitive, and you are sticking a negative label on CSSA. People who get it are stigmatized. The CE says that the amendments to the FOO is done with empathy and compassion. If really you have empathy and compassion, when you face so many people who are poor, when you see unfair distribution of resources, where have your empathy and compassion gone? Next, Ms. Wong Yunhan. Thank you, Chair. I'm called Wong Yunhan. I'm 67 years old. I'm a rag picker. I also work for the rights and welfare of rag pickers. I'd like to tell the administration my own experience. It's very difficult for an elderly person to get a job. We face poverty. We are very passive. There is nothing much we can do. The community must support the elderly. I'm a retired low-ranking civil servant. I have $3,000 in pension every month, but I have to pay rent and a lot of other expenditure. I've tried to find a job, but in these 2 years, I tried 10 jobs, but nobody wanted me. I asked whether I could work part-time, but then I had to work very hard if I want to be a part-time household helper. There is also very low pay. I would need to fetch children to and from school. I need to iron clothes. I need to cook meals.
And you?
I asked how much would be the pay, but it was very, very low. And the person asked me to wait for his call, and he didn't call. I also interviewed for two jobs as cleaners in two clinics. He said it's only a part-time job requiring me to work for 1 or 2 hours. But she, after asking how old I was, they didn't, come back to me afterwards. I've also interviewed for a job in a fast food chain store. I interviewed for the job together with a young lady, and the manager gave a form to that young girl, and he didn't give it to me. I asked him why he didn't give me a form, because outdoor they said that they were recruiting. I said, "Are you applying for a job?" I said, "Yes." And then he went away. He looked at me and smiled and asked him, "Are you going inside to get a form for me?" He looked at me again, smiled, and he went into the room and didn't come out again. I met a friend at that fast food chain, and he told me that I was being stupid because I was already over age and I wouldn't be employed. The government, apparently there is now an age discrimination situation here. I asked the manager why he didn't give me the form. Was it because I was too old? He just smiled. Because he admitted that he thought I was too old and he would be guilty of age discrimination. So he just walked away. So I've interviewed for many jobs. So there's nothing I can do. I can only do rag picking. But people are still not very, friendly to us. The government always asks the elderly to look for work. It's not that we haven't tried, but the government has not been able to help us. I'd like to suggest that the government should consider how it can plan for employment opportunities for the elderly and to offer us more jobs to choose from. Talk to the employers not to discriminate against those who are old, and even the public, and can also help improve the working environment to make it more age-friendly and safer so that we'll be able to live in dignity. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Wong, sharing with us your own personal, example. And this is exactly what is happening to many people in reality. Next, we have Mr. Cheung Mok Kan. Chairman, my name is Cheung Mok Kan. Many people call me Uncle Gun. I call myself the Deputy Chairman of the Alliance for the Concern of the People for those who are, street sleepers. 2 years ago, just before Chinese New Year, I was told by the government that 3 days later they would demolish my hut. So what was I going to do? The government treated, did the government treat the homeless people? Do they treat us like rubbish? I don't want to sleep on the street. All right. A couple of years ago, I was living in a subdivided unit, but now it's costing several thousand dollars, at least 4,000 now. The government, well, the owners doesn't, you know, regulate the owners for charging us expensive, you know, utility fees. So how can we afford to live in those subdivided units? Many people ask why I don't apply for CSSA. Payment. I said I would rather depend on myself rather than relying on the CE. We prefer to be self-reliant, but because if we only give an allowance of 3,000 something, it would not be enough. So even if I stay in a subdivided flat, I can't make ends meet. I would rather depend on myself, so I don't have to depend on the government, and I would at least have my dignity. Last year, some friends and some friendly organizations offered me help, and with the assistance of some council members, I was able to get public housing in less than 6 months. But I'm still not very happy because many other homeless people are still suffering. So I therefore will be continue to fight for the rights of the homeless. I would like to ask the government to set a policy that is friendly to the homeless and do not treat us like garbage. The government should take the lead to actually and not, you know, smear the image of the street sleepers. And the government should also review its CSSA system and come up with measures so that you can improve on the predicament of the poor. Thank you very much. Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Tam Wai Yip. Thank you. Chairman, today I'm speaking on the poverty situation of the mentally handicapped. Well, most of the mentally handicapped now study in special schools. They lack the opportunities for continuous education. After they graduate from secondary education, they can only go to shelter workshops or, you know, and for the last 10 or even 2 or 3 decades, there's been no improvement to the prospects. So we have to understand why these, after you scrap the school, the handicapped students who were studying there were very worried because they didn't have any choice. Even the mentally handicapped can look for employment, but most of them would only earn the minimum wage or only offered part-time, low-skill jobs, which are very labor-intensive. Some of the mentally handicapped, in order to increase their employment opportunities, would volunteer to participate in the so-called assessment scheme. And they, as a result, they're not able to receive the minimum wage protection, and they end up being the working poor. Otherwise, furthermore, these people are subject to different forms of discrimination, which is a very serious problem. I've heard many true stories. That is, if the person has admitted they are mentally handicapped, they wouldn't even stand a chance when they interview for jobs. Even if they apply for jobs, they have to hide their own personal identity. And after they have been employed, and in the course of work, if the employer found out that they are sick, they would be asked to resign. So the mentally handicapped, therefore, will not be able to earn a stable income. How can they, you know, get out of the poverty, you know, trap? So I would like to make the following recommendations. First of all, the government should review the prospect and planning for graduates of special schools in the trains, you know, skill training centers and so on. I think there should be courses, you know, recognized by the qualification framework, so that the mentally handicapped will be able to receive vocational training, and most importantly, we should implement a quota system for employing the handicapped. The government said that this system will stigmatize the handicapped, but the different employment measures to support the handicapped are not sufficient. So with this compulsory employment of the handicapped, I think we can promote an inclusive employment, you know, culture, so that the mental handicapped don't have to rely so much on welfare, and we can really, you know, leverage on their abilities. Yeah, I'm sure there would be room for employment in that area. Next, we have Mr. Zheng Wai-shun. Thank you. I'm from the Labour Federation. In 2012, the government, you know, set up the COP, saying that poverty alleviation is its main priority. It said it wanted to help eliminate intergenerational poverty. But now poverty has reached a 9-year peak. Even after the policy intervention, 1 out of 7 people are still poor. We almost have full employment now, but the poverty problem has never improved. Does it mean that the working class will not be able to share the fruits of our economic progress? Is the government, you know, further aggregating the poverty situation? Mr. Matthew Jones said that this is not reasonable. The Secretary said that we now face structural challenges. First of all, our population is aging, he said. Secondly, he said households are becoming smaller in size, and that would constitute a statistical challenge. But shouldn't the government have already predicted such structural changes and predicted that there would be an increase in the number of elderly, and shouldn't there have been policies to prevent that problem? Is it that you've actually been dragging your feet for too long and your policy measures are not effective enough? Mr. Lord Secretary said in his blog, he says this every week, that is, society is misunderstanding about the poverty report. It's saying that after taking into consideration the intervention of the cash measures, poverty situation has gone back to the situation like as it was in 2016. He said that the poverty line is not the poverty alleviation line. The COP report only talk about the poverty line and not poverty alleviation. Whether it's the poverty line or the poverty alleviation line, isn't it better to have that line rather than not? The government is using the household income to set the poverty line, refusing to measure it in terms of expenditure. But we all know that rents and property prices are very expensive. Rent make up 50% or more of the household expenditure. Shouldn't you set up a basic, you know, wage, you know, to ensure the households have sufficient income to pay for the expenses, so that poverty line is really a effective poverty line, and that you can really tackle poverty. Regarding the allowance for a working family, again, the number of people which benefit is very little, few. The poverty policy should be a safety net. The government should make the commitment. Unfortunately, we don't have long-term welfare policy planning. There is no commitment. The government only resort to public tender to outsource social services. Government policies in housing, welfare, and so on, is all fragmented. But poverty alleviation are related to all these policies. The government should therefore have a comprehensive review of the scattered and fragmented poverty alleviation policy. In a free economy, we have poor households. The government should enact legislation to protect the rights of the workers. Otherwise, we will not be able to improve the livelihood of the grassroots people. The government should also implement a standard wage rate to improve the standard of living for the grassroots. The government should improve their wages and to further, you know, release their potential. Whether it's the poverty line or poverty alleviation line, the government should really set a target. I hope the government will really set a target as to how much it can, you know, reduce the size of the poor population. I think all the deputations have now spoken, so the Secretary will make a brief response. Following that, members may ask questions. Chairman, I'd like to provide some basic statistics or information. Many deputations said that when we analyzed the poverty situation, how do we look at the question of household expenditure? Now, once every 5 years, we will conduct a survey on household expenditure. The next one will be carried out in the year 2019-2020. 2020. Normally, the COP will wait until that survey is completed before we would make a supplementary analysis of the poverty situation. Well, the survey is done once every 5 years. We need to find out about the relationship between the poverty situation and household expenditure. So I think we may have to wait for a year or so before we have the details. The deputations also, what I like to say is that in the last 2 years, our expenditure on medical care, education and welfare has gone up quite a lot. They make up almost 6% of our recurring expenditure. Welfare expenditure for 2018-2019 was up 21.3%. In the budget this year, it's up 19.1%. I understand that in 2018-2019, the expenditure will not, you know, reduce the size of the poverty, the poor population. And we're talking about the number before policy intervention. We hope that in the next few years, the poverty numbers can reflect how our policies during the past year and the next year can reflect the poverty situation. Thank you. The clerk has told me that several members have now, you know, indicated that they would like to speak. They are Ray Chen, Kok Ah Chin, Fernando Zhang, Fu Cha Jun. So may I propose 4 minutes each? Ray Chen, thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the deputations for coming here to reflect to the administration about the concern about the poverty situation and the fact that the government's policies cannot really resolve the problem. Every time we say the government is being mean, I'm always prepared that the government will reply by saying that we are already expending our expenditures on welfare, medical care, and so on. They're telling us that the government is willing to spend the money. The government now has, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars in its reserve, but the government always pretend to be poor. The government always say that poor pretends to be safe, but it is government which is all the best in pretending to be poor.
Yeah.
In the last budget, Paul Chen said he estimated he would have surplus of 40 billion, but last month it is over 58 billion, but then he says it can not compare with previous years. But then until end February, the surplus stands at 98 billion. So you're pretending to be poor. You're just pretending. I know that the caring fund and also distribution of candies and goodies are welcomed by some, not welcomed by others, because people think that it is one-off and it's like distributing alms. But then when you go to the community, the $4,000 mean a lot to them because it's like half a month's salary. But this year, there is no distribution of goodies and people are not getting it even for last year. I support OALA and I support long-term poverty alleviation policies. But then you have such a big surplus, you should return some wealth to the public. There is a big difference between your estimate and the resultant number. Just spend that difference. You also return rates and taxes, and you can also use that for poverty alleviation. Now let's talk about the OALA. I heard that elderly people think that they are subject to over-stringent vetting and they think it's hurting their dignity, so they do not apply. Actually, from the first day of OALA, we asked that there should not be a means test. Even the pro-establishment camp said that you should raise the threshold. But then Matthew Jung said there would be a review, so allow it to pass first. And he said, why should we waste too much time haggling over the details without helping the elderly right away? So it was promised there would be a review. But even today, there has not been a real review. Secretary, don't talk to me about annual inflation-related reviews. But I'm talking about a real review. From day one, members across the political spectrum have said that there should be a raising of the income limit because it's a kind of a show of gratitude for the contribution made by elderly instead of subjecting them to over-stringent vetting. Will you do that kind of review? Secretary. Chairman, in January 2017, in the PA, we have told you the review results. One-person, two-person income limits have been raised by a big margin. I don't have the figures here. I can't memorize them. But we should be talking about 300,000 instead of 118,000. But you remember what the FTU and DAB said, and even the Liberal Party said? What they said? They were talking about 300,000, 500,000, and 1 million. But now you're only talking about 300,000. Anything to add? Well, I think I have answered the question. KK Kwok, Chairman. First, I'd like to thank the deputations for coming, especially Ms. Wong Yut Han and Mr. Chung Mok Kun. The secretary and senior officials will never understand their plight. When we talk about a lack of protection for our elderly, the administration is actually making life even more difficult for them. They raise the CSSA elderly eligibility age to 65, and they are saying people live to 120 years. I hope secretary and your officials will not be so heartless. Please, don't be so harsh in your words. Like, we have Ms. Wong with us. She is 67. She experienced callous treatment when she worked, and she was subject to discrimination. But you know, she's smart. And you know, the potential employers know how to steer clear of the law, and they would just keep silent, even if he discriminates against your age. Well, talking about the cash subsidies and review of CSSA, you say that would take 5 years, meaning you are telling the elderly people to suffer for another 5 years. If you can live through those 5 years, and if the review is positive, then you will be given something more. But if the review would say things have to be tightened up even further, I really don't know how we can help the elderly. So, secretary, what can you do in these 5 years in the interim? Secondly, you have been moving the goalposts about the poverty line. You say housing is also a kind of subsidy, and you seem to be persuading yourself that you have done a lot. But, well, I can only accept what you say because my IQ is not as high as yours. Well, is 10% good enough for you? Are you going to stop there? I hope you have a better target. And number three, you force them to work. But what about your policies that would help elderly find a job, like Ms. Wong? I hope the secretary will answer Ms. Wong and how you can help her. She is meeting a lot of failures already. Will the SWD help her in other ways? Please answer this directly. Well, first, I have to clarify some misunderstanding on the part of Dr. Kwok. I was referring to the expenditure survey done by the Census and Statistics Department. It is done once every 5 years. But you are using that survey for review. No, sorry, there is more misunderstanding. We actually do our review annually, and we do it on the basis of inflation. I think you have heard me talk about this many times. Within the year, we are going to complete our review on the subsidies under CSSA. As for employment assistance, at the Employees Retraining Board, a quarter of the participants are over the age of 60. 35% are between 50 and 59. Talking about job retraining, we have half of the people who are over the age of 50. And last year, in September, the Labour Department enhanced the employment scheme for middle-aged and old people. Well, I think it was dodging the question. Please allow some time for the Secretary to answer Ms. Wong, because I wanted a direct answer. Ms. Wong talked about difficulty in finding a job. Secretary, she can contact the Labour Department for help. He's asking you, Ms. Wong, to go to the Labour Department. There is nothing more I can say. Dr. Fernando Zheng, Chairman. I think Ms. Wong is wrong in a way because she did not contact the Labour Department. Who would have helped her? Ms. Wong, I feel sorry for you that in this room, that is what the Secretary said. I was with you. I was with you, following you to pick cartons in Shangshui. I cannot imagine that our officials can be so callous and heartless. Ms. Wong is a retired civil servant. She worked in hospitals. She was a cleaner. She was processing high-risk medical waste. She worked hard for many years, but she only has $3,000 every month in pension. It's good that she has a pension, but it doesn't sustain her, and she has been rag-picking for many years. I don't know whether, as the Secretary said, the Labour Department can really help these elderly poor. Actually, a person at the age of 67, well, I think Ms. Wong wants to be self-reliant. She has the determination to do that. But how many poor people enjoy and love rag picking? How many elderly people, when they are 60 odd or 70 years old, want to work in low-skilled and highly intensive manual jobs involving moving around heavy articles so that they would be sprained in the lower back? And that happened to me 2 weeks ago. Why is it that there is so little retirement protection? Even with policy intervention, we have 30% of elderly people who are poor. And Secretary, you know better than I do. You call the aging population a tsunami. Well, we have heard so many people talk about the situation, the ethnic minorities, new arrivals, the disabled, the elderly, children. So many people are poor. And we have the CCF chairman, academics. We have the COP. I don't know where the COP is today. And you do your math in such a smart way. And yet, there are still so many problems. Apart from asking people to go to the Labour Department and asking me to call the SWD hotline, what else can you do? Chairman, every year, the Labour Department helps tens of thousands of people to land a job. I don't think by saying that it sounds like a joke. I hope the Labour Department can help those who want to find a job, land a job. So we're just telling people to go to the Labour Department, and you think that is the be-all and end-all for elderly poor. Chairman, the Labour Department helps unemployed people to find a job. Whether it can solve all the problems, well, I think there will be a certain degree of difficulty. Apart from going to the Labour Department, what can the Secretary and the officials propose to do? What else? Chairman, I think I have answered the question. Dr. Zheng, you can consider having a second round. I can share your feelings. Next, Pun Xiuping. Thank you, Chair. I thank deputations for coming. In fact, many people sneer at the fact that with the COP, we have more poor people. If you look at the poverty situation, poverty has not been alleviated. Recently, Hong Kong has been listed as the city with the highest living expenses in the world. While listening to the Secretary, the poverty line is drawn according to income. As many deputations said, if you look at employment for the elderly, that is extremely difficult. And grassroots workers, including contract workers and cleaners, they are working all right. We have full employment, but they have a very low standard of living. Secretary, so many deputations have spoken. I hope you will consider their views. I can see from your paper that you will continue to use the poverty line in order to analyze and monitor Hong Kong's poverty situation and continue to assess the effectiveness of the various measures, and you would use data in order to consider enhancing the policies. My question for you is, how effective do you think your policies have been? That's the first question. Secondly, would it be like what deputations are saying? You should consolidate your measures and set a target, including one for CSSA. And what is important is a policy for elderly employment.
Including minimum wage, standard wage, would you take a comprehensive review of the poverty situation in Hong Kong? If the poverty gap becomes, you know, wider and wider, it will really affect social stability. As the policy bureau, shouldn't you come up with a clear target so that we would know what you're going to do going forward? Secretary, of course, to assess the effectiveness of our policies in the last couple of years, we have to look at the, if we want to look at the 2018 numbers, we will have to wait until the end of this year before we have the figures for 2018 available. In 2020, we'll be able to have the figures for 2019. So to assess the effectiveness of our policy, our leverage policy in the last 2 years, you may say that there is a time lag. We have to wait until those information are available before we can assess the effectiveness of our policy measures in the last 2 years. I think in economic paper, if you look at 2016-2017, you'll find that in 2017, the government policies could only, you know, that is after policy intervention, we were able to, you know, bring the poverty percentage to 14.7%. Although the number of, there's an increase of 3.1% of the number of people who have actually left the poverty population. For 2017, 2018, 2019, and 18 and 19, we've made some adjustments. Mr. A. Chen asked about our OLOA, which we have, you know, enhanced. We have also the higher OLOA, which in 2018 was implemented. So the effectiveness of these measures, we will find out soon. So for most of our measures, other than helping those who are below the poverty line, many of these measures also help those who are above the poverty line. For example, the allowance for the working low-income working families. I think these families are actually above the poverty line. I think they can apply even if they are 40% above the poverty line. So we're not just talking about those who are below the poverty line. Mr. Siu Kachin. Thank you. Secretary, I agree with you that going to the Labor Department for help, you know, when looking for work is not, you know, something that is shameful. But do you know that, you know, the Madam Wong was wrong, was crying when she heard this suggestion. I think this is something that we should really, you know, think about. Somebody asked the secretary how much is a catty of cardboards. I've actually, you know, picked racks with the scavengers and went to a market in Maple Street. For 1 hour, I was picking racks myself. And the amount that I was able to collect, you know, I was paid $6.50. That is, I was doing it all myself for 1 hour. So that would be, you know, that will reflect the poverty situation of the elderly. I think the deputations made two remarks, which really was, you know, left a very strong impression on me. So empathy is not something that is selective. And secondly, the deputation, they will rely on their own hands than on the CE. I think the deputations have, you know, understand what they were, what they meant. That is, it's better to rely on their own hands than on the government. So my question for the secretary is in relation to the paper. I've always proposed that after you've set the poverty line, you should set a target for poverty alleviation. You said that the poverty line is not the poverty alleviation line. But in your paper, you have offered a new explanation. On page, paragraph 8, you say that setting a quantitative target for policy alleviation would mean that should not just benefit those living under the poverty line. That is, for those at the margin of the poverty line would better. Once you set the poverty line, you would only focus on those below the poverty line, and those at the margin would suffer. I don't think that is right. You're saying that those below the poverty line and those at the margin, you are putting them, pitching them one against the other. That is, you're saying that you help offer more help to those below the poverty line, it will be at the expense of those who are at the margin. So I hope you can explain that. And poverty alleviation does not depend just on cash, you know, subsidies or benefits. I think you should, you know, eliminate or reduce poverty by through primary allocation, that is, and not secondary allocation, that is, on subjects like minimum wage and so on. Those are the areas where you can bring about improvements rather than resorting to welfare measures or cash subsidies. So the question of working poor, I understand that you are now reviewing the contracts for contract staff and so on, and you need to put in extra effort on that. But this is something which I think you should step up your effort. Any response, Secretary? I believe regarding your question on target for policy alleviation, if we adopt the concept of relative poverty and then we set some target for poverty alleviation, in terms of priority, obviously we will focus on you know, lowering the poverty numbers. Now, poverty is a relative concept for a three-member household. We're talking about allowance of 15,000, and for a four-person household is 19,900, and the level is ever increasing. One difficulty with poverty alleviation is that poverty is relative, and it's difficult to assess the changes in income. So it's therefore also difficult to set a target. It's difficult to predict 3-4 years from now what would be the household income, the medium household income for a four-member family, and so on. So technically, there is a difficulty here, and once we've set the target, it will not really help in terms of helping us to set the priorities. I don't know whether you want me to answer the latter questions. Thank you. It will now be my turn. First of all, I'd like to thank all the deputations for coming here. Many of them are willing to come here to give us their views, especially the story of Madam Wong, you know, an elderly lady, and the difficulty she faced when she looked for work. That was a real life example. I'm not very happy with the secretary's response when you advised that she should go to the Labor Department for help. If you say Madam Wong should go to the department and the department can help her find work, perhaps, but the topic of our discussion today is to explore how the Bureau can help the elderly find employment. In January, we had the debate with the CE about the SSA, you know, benefits for those between 65 and we scolded the CE for the policy proposal. At the special meeting and at the second, you know, Q&A session with the CE, we pursued that question, and she said that she was able to listen to our views humbly. But if we were to help the elderly look for employment, the secretary said, please go to the Labor Department. Isn't that a bit callous? Madam Wong can simply look up, you know, the pages on job market. She doesn't even need assistance from the Labor Department. The question is, how can we, you know, assist through the government's policies, especially for those age 60, 65? For these elderly persons, they still have the ability and they still want to work. How can you help them, you know, find work? How do you help them? I thought the secretary would be able to give us some advice or suggestions as to how we can help the elderly, you know, enhance their value, so to speak. Perhaps I can now give more time to the secretary to further explain. Perhaps we have misunderstood him. Perhaps there's a lot more that the Bureau can do to help the elderly look for employment. Chairman, I provided some information for members just now. That is the ERB and the Labor Department are now helping middle-aged and the elderly look for employment. As to how we can help an elderly person to enhance his value, so to speak, the ERB and the Labor Department hopes that we can do that. Some people, after they've left a job they've worked for many years and when looking for a new job, other than the age factor, the employer may think that that person might be a bit old and don't have the experience. So hence the difficulty for that person to find work. And therefore, through the ERB, we hope that we can provide training for these people. For those over 50, attending training at the ERB, more than 55% of them are over 50, one quarter of them are over 60. That is those people who are attending training courses at the ERB. So I hope you don't mind looking for assistance because they can really help you find work which would suit you, or they may help you, you know, enhance your skills so that you'll be able to find the work that you would like to find. Madam Wong said she went to a restaurant. The manager simply, you know, laughed and ignored her, and she didn't have a chance. How would you see that sort of situation? Does the Bureau have a role to play here, or does she have any? Do you have any advice for her? Chairman, I'm being repetitive here already. If someone doesn't have the experience and the person applies for a job, that person might think that other than his or her age, he doesn't have any experience. What experience do you need if you work in a restaurant? I believe you need some skill training if you apply for a job in a restaurant. Although I've spent a very short time personally experiencing, you know, how one is trained in a bar. And I think in this area, the ERB can help. Chairman, first of all, I'd like to thank the deputations for coming here. All the stories I believe the government should hear clearly. in handling welfare issues, I don't think the government has the compassion or the empathy. The story of Madam Wong. Really, you know, make us wonder what we can do. People of Hong Kong are self-reliant. If they can resolve their own problems, they don't need any handouts, they don't need to apply for welfare. That's the spirit of Hong Kong. Unfortunately, our welfare protection measures is not, you know, catching up. So my question for you, Secretary, is that the poverty numbers, for the poverty numbers, there is a time lag. The COP will report on the situation of the preceding year. For example, for 2017, the situation, the figures will be released at the end of 2018. Well, I understand government takes time to collect the data and analyze the data, but sometimes before, when the government formulate any policy, or when the welfare organizations formulate their policies, such poverty information is very important. So I'd like to ask the Secretary whether you can actually bring forward the announcement of these statistics. And secondly, in Hong Kong, transportation and housing are very expensive, especially housing. So I'd like to ask the Secretary this question, that is whether the Labour and Welfare Bureau has come up with any measures that can really focus on that, so that those people who are poor can feel that the government is really caring for them. Chairman, regarding bringing forward the announcement of those findings, the data for 2018 will only be ready in a few months' time. By the time we analyzed those data and make an announcement, we can only advance it by no more than a couple of months. It's not possible that in 2019 we will announce the poverty numbers for 2019. We have to wait for the following year before we can announce the numbers for 2019.
In terms of the work process, we can only expedite the process by just 1 or 2 months. Well, there were these two distinct examples under the present policy where the poverty line was able to help us. Remember, at first, we used to have LIVA, low-income family subsidy. Now we call it the working family subsidy. It is because we saw that under the poverty line, especially when we have included government recurrent subsidy, still 48% who were below the poverty line would still be regarded as poor households. So we wanted to find a way to help the households who are in this category. That is why we had LIVA and now the working family allowance. And then if we discount those who have CSSA, still there are 48% who were elderly people. And that is why we came up with the consultation and review on retirement protection. And then we announced in 2017 that we would have an enhanced OALA. Therefore, those two policies were directly related to analyses done because of the poverty line. But then, of course, there is always a time gap between analysis and policy implementation. Okay, I like to say that even if you can compress your timetable by 2 months, I hope you will just do it, because you will have in very important reference material for making your policies. I've heard the member. Thank you. Last speaker for this session, Leung Yu Chung. At the end of last year, you released the 2017 Poverty Situation Report. And we knew that the poverty population had risen instead of having been reduced. We are an economically advanced city, and we have a very big reserve. I don't know whether the Secretary feels ashamed. There is much the administration can do, but you are just doing something symbolic. You are not really helping those who need your help. Let us talk about poor families. The women would like to work, but your policies cannot help them find jobs and release their working ability. We have had community nannies, and you have mutual help childcare centers. You talk about continuous improvement, but whatever you do, you are not helping more people. It's not that you don't have resources, but why are you so miserly? Why are you not willing to spend more so we can release more labor from poor families, and by working, they would have their situation helped? We have asked all these questions, and you have always told us that you are doing something, you are doing more. But if you look at the policy address, those measures are not going to help. People would like to set up mutual aid childcare centers, but then the feedback is you are not helping these people where need, not where help is needed. So, Secretary, can you tell us clearly and specifically whether you can spend more resources in this regard by providing community nannies and childcare centers so the women can work? Secretary, I think we had already given the information at the special finance committee meetings. I think members are going to ask similar questions. In brief, in this year and the coming year, if you are talking about full-day childcare centers for children from 1 to 3 years old, the increase will be over 50%. But of course, the shortage is also huge, and we will continue to work on that. In the budget, there is this proposed measure that we'd like to buy places for providing the service, and we are particularly talking about full-day childcare centers catering to children of 1 to 3 years, and we'd like to increase services in all 18 districts. But again, it takes time. Even if you are going to buy places, or you are going to buy property to set up these centers, you have to know that you must make it convenient for the women. If you require them to travel a few stops or stations in order to take back their children, it won't work. Why don't you do more with housing estates? Community nannies is a much better way to do it. Chairman, in the coming financial year, we'll have more resources to improve allowance for community nannies. And we'd like to consolidate services at centers, like we're going to provide after-school childcare service so that the women in these families can work. Thank you. This is the end of the first session. We'll take a 5-minute break.